On Friday, the president did make his view clear about a two-state solution, but he also suggested that Netanyahu was open to that view. So did Netanyahu express to the president that, or why didn't the president think that?
They had a very constructive conversation, and I think I just need to leave it at that.
In just the past week, Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu has repeated over and over and over again that he intends to prevent a two-state solution between Israel and Palestine. But John Kirby and Joe Biden think we're all morons because they claim that a two-state solution is still possible, even with Benjamin Netanyahu continuing to serve as the prime minister of Israel. So on Friday, Biden spoke with Netanyahu for the first time in many, many weeks about possible resolutions to the ongoing conflict. Yet again, Bibi rejected the prospect of a separate Palestinian state. Nonetheless, Biden told reporters several hours after the call the following. There are a number of types of two-state solutions.
Are there?
Yeah, are there? What does that even mean? There's a number of countries that are members of the UN that don't have their own militaries. Number of states that have limitations. And so I think there's ways in which this could work. It's not, okay, so let me just make this clear. It's not a two-state solution if Israel has power over the Palestinian state, meaning they get to call the shots in regard to whether the Palestinians have a military to protect themselves, whether Israel has control over what goes in and what goes out of the territory. Like, it's just a ridiculous notion.
No, no, guys, it's worse than that, because Biden just threw away the two-state solution.
He did.
That comment is saying we're not doing a two-state solution. Netanyahu didn't listen to me, I listened to him. I'm not the boss of him, he's the boss of me. Because the two-state solution is two independent sovereign states. If you say a state without a military, that's the half withdrawal that they did in Gaza,
yep,
where they're still super frustrated, Israel's still in charge, and they go, well, technically we withdrew, but if you do anything wrong, we're gonna cut your water, power, electricity, or anything that we think you did wrong, and we're gonna bomb the living crap out of you and kill all of you. But hey, we withdrew. So if you're gonna do that, that's gonna make it worse, not better. And here's the president of the United States saying, okay, I'm gonna give Netanyahu everything he wants. It's disgusting.
So this is a side note, but I've been dying to make this point because I think it's important. The argument against a ceasefire that we keep hearing from Israel over and over again is, well, the second we do a ceasefire, then we're gonna be victims of Hamas. Hamas is going to, it's gonna threaten our security. Hamas is gonna come attack us again. Okay, is Benjamin Netanyahu unable to use all the weapons to lean on the Iron Dome, which we fund year after year, to protect the people who are currently living in Israel? Is he unable to secure the border with Gaza? Okay, because it's just such a, if that's the case, if all those weapons and the Iron Dome is doing nothing to help protect Israeli civilians, why are we paying for it?
Yeah, guys.
And I'm saying that because Hamas and the people in the Gaza Strip don't have a military. Okay, yes, Hamas was able to carry out those atrocities and those terror attacks, but they don't have a navy, they don't have an army, they don't have, you know, they don't have like the war, the military capabilities that Israel does. And so they keep talking about this as if this is a symmetrical war, when in reality it's an asymmetrical war. And the reason why the IDF didn't respond to what Hamas was doing is because they were too busy protecting illegal Israeli settlements in the West Bank. It took them 6 hours to respond to what Hamas was doing. That's on Netanyahu, okay? The real threat to the safety of Israelis is Benjamin Netanyahu. But anyway, they can't have a ceasefire, it would be so dangerous. Okay.
Yeah, so look guys, a couple of things here. Number one, this whole idea of that Israel is being oppressed by the Hamas and the Palestinians, it's a mirage. Like, so I'm not saying that Hamas didn't attack Israel and cause damage, they definitely did and we condemn them for it. But the idea that they're somehow stronger than Israel, that the Palestinians are endangering Israel's existence, instead of Israel literally blocking the existence of their state, is topsy-turvy. It's just a total Orwellian talking point, as if the Palestinians control the Israelis rather than the other way around.
That's the way it keeps getting framed.
Yeah, And so I want you to understand, anyone who tells you that is purposely lying to you to try to trick you. No, it's Israel that has been occupying the Palestinians for 75 years. And then this idea of, well, I mean, they can't govern themselves if we let them. They want to kill all the Israelis, and so these monsters cannot be allowed to ever govern themselves. Well, couldn't every empire use that against every minority? So the Turks say, well, the Armenians, if we let them, they'd kill all the Turks. Well, at the time where the Turks were oppressing them, they might have. Maybe the Armenian rebels might have wanted to kill all the Turks. That doesn't mean you can't give them a state. It doesn't mean that you can't free them. That then, if you go by that logic, no one will ever be free. Oh, well, you don't love your oppressor enough. We've been occupying you and putting our boot on your neck. Well, you don't love us. You don't love us enough. That's it. We're gonna put more boot on your neck, and we're gonna kill your family members. Why don't you love us enough? No, it's your fault for not loving us, so we're gonna keep oppressing you. Nonsense, nonsense. Lastly, if you say the Palestinians are the only people in the world who can't govern themselves, you are deeply racist. Period. Period. Don't tell me nonsense excuses about, they can't be trusted. You're saying they're. I'm a racist, I hate Palestinians, and I think that they're subhuman and cannot govern themselves like every other ethnicity in the world. Every other ethnicity in the world can govern themselves except Palestinians. No, that's a deeply, deeply racist ideology.
So let's get back to Biden. Asked what Netanyahu was open to, Biden said, I'll let you know. But he rejected the notion that a so-called two-state solution is impossible as long as Netanyahu is in power. No, it's not. And he brushed off the idea of imposing conditions on American security aid to Israel if the prime minister continues to resist. Go to the last graphic here, because I just want to remind you of what Biden said in a closed door fundraiser just this past December. At a fundraiser event in December, President Biden singled out Israel's Prime Minister for National Security, Itamar Ben-Gvir, by name, saying in a speech that he and the new folks don't want anything remotely approaching a two-state solution, adding that they want retribution not only against Hamas, but against all Palestinians. Biden said that during the fundraiser. So why is he lying to the American people right now? That's what I want to know. Why is he willing to tell the truth to his donors in a closed door fundraiser? But when it comes to speaking to the American people, he lies to us and tells us, no, two state solution is totally possible. In fact, it's totally possible with Netanyahu in office. Come on.
Yeah, look, once he brushed off the idea of imposing conditions on Israel, that is a unilateral surrender to Netanyahu. That is the president of the United States saying, I'm not allowed to question him. He can say anything he wants, and I know, because I said it behind closed doors, that they don't want a two-state solution, and Netanyahu says it all the time. He talks to me, then he goes on a national stage, or an international stage, and goes, I'm not gonna listen to America, they're gonna listen to me. And we're not gonna have a two-state solution, and Biden comes and goes, I won't impose any conditions. I swear to you, I beg you, Netanyahu, I beg you. You loser, you're pathetic.
I'm just
totally pathetic.
I'm sick of the gaslighting and I'm sick of the lies. We're not morons. We see what's happening on the ground in Gaza. We see the high civilian death toll. We see all those children suffering or just dying. And then at the same time, you have Biden speaking from both sides of his mouth, telling his donors one thing, and then lying to the American people, saying something entirely different. And by the way, how did Benjamin Netanyahu respond to Biden's claims that a two-state solution is still possible, even with Benjamin Netanyahu as the leader of Israel? Here's what Netanyahu said. I will not compromise on full Israeli security control over the entire area west of the River Jordan. And this is irreconcilable with a Palestinian state, AKA from the river to the sea, Israel will control the land. Pretty clear. Yesterday, he even doubled down and actually bragged about his role in preventing a two-state solution, saying, my insistence is what has prevented over the years the establishment of a Palestinian state that would have constituted an existential danger to Israel. not noting that he's the real danger to Israel, of course. As long as I am prime minister, I will continue to strongly insist on this. And the Likud party's original platform stated that between the sea and the Jordan, there will be only one Israeli sovereignty. But when John Kirby was asked about Netanyahu saying all of this, saying that Israel will control all of the land west of the Jordan River, he basically did everything he could to avoid answering the question. Take a look.
Did the president address Netanyahu's use of the phrase from the river to the sea in their conversation today? I know the White House has previously said that phrase is divisive, so.
I'm not aware that that specific phrase was discussed.
Do you condemn him using that phrase?
Look, there's a connotation with that phrase. We've talked about this before. But when you know, when you use the phrase river to the sea, it speaks basically to the mantra of Hamas, and in their manifesto, where they basically describe the geographic bounds of what they believe to be Palestine. And if you look at it on the map, if you go look at the four corners that they describe it, it's basically the state of Israel. They just don't believe it should exist. So again, it's not a phrase that that we recommend using, given because of that context.
But this wasn't Hamas. This was Netanyahu.
I understand. I don't have anything more on that, and I certainly don't have anything more on the conversation to read out with respect to that.
I love that the reporter had to clarify. We're not talking about Hamas. We're talking about Benjamin Netanyahu, the prime minister of Israel. And Kirby followed that up with, "This isn't about trying to twist somebody's arm or force a change in their thinking," meaning Israel's thinking. Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu has made clear his concerns about that. President Biden has made clear his strong conviction that a two-state solution is still the right path ahead, and we're going to continue to make that case.
No, you're not. Biden just said that he's willing to do a nonsense non-two-state solution where Israel controls Palestinian military, security, and everything else. That's still an occupation.
Yeah.
So you're not in favor of the two-state solution. Okay, by the way, I know people in power in this country don't care about hypocrisy at all. They love hypocrisy. So are we rehiring the deans of Harvard and Penn? Because they got fired for not strongly enough condemning from the river to the sea. Here's John Kirby. Is he gonna get fired?
No,
is he gonna get fired?
No, Cenk, but you're mixing things up. It's okay when one side says it.
Oh.
It's the Palestinian side that's not allowed.
And by the way, the Palestinian side isn't doing it. Netanyahu is actually committing the genocide from the river to the sea. He's in the middle of committing that genocide, and then he brags about it. John Kirby didn't denounce him at all.
Nope.
I heard that if you say from the river to the sea and somebody doesn't denounce you strongly enough, they should be fired. I know. So can anyone in power, in media or in politics, admit we're never going to be honest or fair, ever? If Israel does something, it's perfectly okay. We don't care what it is. We don't care what kind of war crimes, ethnic cleansing, occupation, etc. It's perfectly okay. Palestinians, you dare oppose your own occupation? That's it, you monster, savage terrorists. Yeah, I'm sick of it. I'm sick of the lies. All right, now. Netanyahu just told you he's not a partner for peace. He said it very clearly, never was favored the Palestinian state, never gonna be in favor of the Palestinian state. And as long as I'm in charge, I'm gonna block it. You just saw him say it. You saw the quotes for yourself. Not a partner for peace. I understand that's why we're not allowed to talk to Palestinians about peace. Oh, Hamas is not a partner. Palestinian Authority is not a partner. Nobody's a partner for peace. It's their fault, it's their fault. Okay, now it's Netanyahu's fault. There's no question about it, right? No, another excuse. Oh no, it's okay if Israel doesn't want peace. It's always the Palestinians' fault. It's their fault for being occupied. It's their fault for getting killed, 25,000 of them now. And then, look guys, whether you like it or not, it's not just about the Palestinians, it's about Israel. As long as the occupation exists, it'll never have peace.
Nope.
And you can say, oh Cenk, don't say that. It doesn't matter if I say it or not.
It's just demonstrably true. It's demonstrably true.
Do you think that any people, people from Ecuador, people from Nigeria, people from Palestine, any people are gonna say, oh yeah, you can permanently occupy us. We surrender to you, we'll now be your dogs. We'll just do, you can do whatever you want to us. We just give up, we give up completely. Total utter surrender. We are now servants of the Israelis. Do you think they're gonna say that? Or do you think they're gonna fight back? You'd have to be the dumbest person in the world to not think they're gonna fight back. You might say, hey, it's wrong. I don't want them to fight back. I don't want them to kill civilians. I say that. I say that I don't want them to kill civilians. But it doesn't matter because they're going to fight back. So the only way to get to peace is through peace. You did it. Israel did a deal with Egypt, peace deal, and it worked. Peace deals work. Peace deals bring you peace. War brings you war. So Israel's got a choice to make. America doesn't have a choice because our leaders will never, ever be fair or honest, ever. They will do whatever any Israeli prime minister says. It doesn't matter if he's left wing or right wing. And if you're denying that, that doesn't matter either, guys. The whole world knows that Israel is in charge. No, you could say, no. Every American president tells every Israeli leader that they can have money unconditionally, no matter how much they don't listen to us. But we're gonna trick everyone into thinking, no, Israel's not in charge. You can try, but it's not gonna work. It's never gonna give you peace. The only thing that can give you peace is end the occupation. If you don't want that, then okay, you want permanent war. And the next time you're attacked, don't be like, oh my God, I'm so surprised. Oh my God, I can't believe that they didn't accept our occupation. Don't they know we're superior to them and we get to occupy them permanently? I can't believe they attacked. Now, we have a right to defend ourselves. They have no rights, no right to defend themselves. And they can't govern those losers, savage terrorists. Well, it's not racist. No, deeply racist. The occupation is a moral evil. It is the core of the problem. If you don't end the occupation, you will have war forever and ever. And America will pay for it, and America will lie on behalf of Israel. And that's what's happened every single time. And now our president has surrendered to Netanyahu. He's loathed even in Israel. Even in Israel, he's still loathed. But no one loves Netanyahu more than Joe Biden. Now he's killed a two-state solution. Thanks a lot, Joe Biden. You loser, you pathetically weak creature.
Thanks for watching the video, guys. We also love it if you hit the join button below because that makes you a member. And members allow us to be independent, honest. We could be as progressive as we want. No corporate media influence. And that's all because of you guys. We love doing the show with our members. Hit the join button. Become one of the Young Turks.